Audio presents this unabridged recording of The Cunning Man, written by Celia Rees and read by Shirley Barthelmie. Dedication reads, for Rees, Joan and Roy. Chapter 1. It was not always the same dream, but it always began in the same way. They are going down to the beach, Finn, her brothers Con and Aidan, and Mum and Dad, a happy family outing, in the days when there were happy family outings. The weather is perfect. The sun is shining and the beach is crowded. Children shouting, jumping in and out of the waves, laughing and calling as they play. Everything is fine, to start with. It is an ideal day. But even at this point, Finn isn't sure. There is something about this beach that makes her uneasy. Backed by tall, crumbling cliffs, it pitches steeply. The firm sand is deeply fissured, split with channels which run between towering rocks, all piled up like giants' play bricks. The beach is not human scale at all. It is too deep, too big. The people are too small. The uneasy feeling grows steadily, seeping in slowly at first, then welling up inside her, until she wants to shout out to all around her, to warn them that something terrible is going to happen. But she says nothing. In the dream, she says nothing. She just carries on walking, following her family in their search for a likely spot to settle. They go up and down the hollows and hummocks in the hard, wet sand, burdened with bags and deck chairs, picnic basket and beach toys. She cannot see the sea, only hear it, a dull, far-off boom. Suddenly, for no reason, she feels slightly sick. She tastes seawater, thick in her throat like a premonition. The booming ceases, replaced by the click-clacking of pebbles as the water withdraws. This sound goes on for a long time. Too long. People look up, look around, as if alerted by some deep sense that something is wrong. Then they see it. Some are gesturing in frantic warning. Some are pointing. Happy beach cries turning to panicking screams as the enormous wave mounts and mounts. Some people race forward, still intent on play, jumping right in as the surf thunders down. For them, there will be no coming back. They will be tumbled over and over, dragged backwards and forwards over the rocks and boulders, torn to pieces by the force of the water, because this is no ordinary sea. This is tsunami, tidal wave. Sand and shingles sucked up from the shore show inside the greeny glass wall, muddying the boiling foam as the waves thunder and fall. And always the sound, the huge explosive boom, like pressure waves inside the head, the slow, ominous drag back and back, the muffled clash as boulders the size of family cars roll and crash. Everyone is running now, fleeing for their lives, belongings forgotten, children crying, babies wailing in the screaming scramble to get away from this murderous sea. But however fast they run, the sea is faster. Faster than any human, faster than a horse can gallop, faster than a train. And each time the crash is followed by the dragging back. The little dream of escape before the nightmare wave. Finn is running too, going as fast as she can. Sometimes her legs are short, like when she was small. Sometimes they are long and lithe, like they are now. But long or short, there is no escape. She looks from side to side, searching for Mum and Dad, Con and Adi, but there is no one she recognises to left or right. She will die with strangers. In front of her is the sheer cliff face. Behind her, the sea. She feels but does not see the last wave, looming above her head, tall as a tower block. She throws her head back to scream, but her final cry is lost in the crashing surf. Seawater pours into her mouth, rushing down her throat, making her gag and choke. Then there is nothing. She is being tumbled over and over inside the glass wall of water, bright hair floating, tangled in the dark weed. The tide comes back, foaming pink, blood-stained and streaked, and all down its length, the beach is empty. The dream always ends in the same way. Finn lies unable to move, caught in a state between waking and sleeping, as if some paralyzing drug is working in her. Her mind is alive, her eyes are open, But her body is gripped by corpse-like stillness, her limbs frozen and useless, her mouth stretched open in a silent scream. Chapter 2. In the morning, Finn knew she'd had the dream again. She woke with a thick, salty taste still in her mouth and felt drained, with the remnants of a headache like after a migraine. She hadn't had the dream in years, not since Dad left. Just like then, the dream was accompanied by something else, a kind of precognition, a sickening, seesawing sense that something bad was about to happen. She lay for a while, listening to a sound familiar, yet unfamiliar. The tide on the shoreline. This was not the deep, muffled boom and crash that made her sick to even think about. This was gentle, the soothing whisper of surf on sand. She relaxed a little. The sound must have penetrated her sleep, bringing the dream with it. Finn got out of bed and went over to the window. They had arrived last night, but it had been too dark to see much. There were no street lights here. The place they were staying in was called the Salt House. It stood on its own at the end of a long lane. There had been no moon, no stars, no comforting city glow. Finn had never known such blackness. It was like stepping into another dimension. Even the light of their torches had been rendered feeble. It was all they could do to find the front door. It was different now. Last night's clouds had cleared away. It was still early, but the air was mild and already warming with the promise of a lovely day. She leaned out into it, her arms resting on the thick stone sill, taking in her new surroundings. Down from the house was a little harbour. She could just see boat masts and a bit of the wall. To the right, a small promontory topped with pines shadowed the house. Out back was a rough patch of garden, and beyond that the sea stretched away, mirroring the sky in a deep, almost Mediterranean blue. There was no wind. Waves broke white at a point far out. Apart from that, the surface seemed almost motionless. The long curve of Westwater Bay stretched into the distance, waves creaming into the wide, flat beach in a thin, curling hush of surf. A loud ringing made her jump. Someone at the front door. The ringing stopped, and then began again, more prolonged and insistent. Why didn't someone answer it? Where were the boys? Or Mum, for that matter? All right! Finn yelled down the stairs as the ringing started up again. I'm coming! I'm coming! A blurred face loomed close through the ribbed glass panelling as she wrenched open the door. Hello! She said, holding the door half open. Hi! The young man stepped backwards. I'm Mike. Mike Treherne. He grinned. The tanned skin round his light blue eyes creased and crinkled. I've come about the work. His eyebrows quirked up. They were bleached almost white. Streaky fair hair showed in a thick fringe under the bill of his baseball cap. Can I speak to your mum? Finn looked him up and down. He was tall, a little under 6 foot, she guessed, well muscled and very brown. He wore a surfer T-shirt, ripped and faded. Baggy jeans, almost colourless, frayed by heavy wearing, rode low on his hips. He wore no socks, and his unlaced work boots were old and cracked, scuffed white across the toe caps. Finn turned away, suddenly aware that she was only wearing the T-shirt she slept in. He was scrutinising her, too. Mom! She yelled. There's a... She paused before saying man. She judged him to be maybe 17, 18, older than her, but not really a man yet, although his strong build and the fine golden stubble on his chin showed he was no longer a boy. She adjusted what she had been going to say. There's a person to see you! There was no reply from inside. They were left, staring at each other. I'll go and see where she is, Finn said, pulling her T-shirt down at the front. Hang on a minute. She left him on the doorstep and went into the kitchen. Her brothers were sitting at the table, mouths full of cereal. "Where's Mum?" Finn demanded. "And why didn't either of you get the door?" "We didn't know who it was," Aidan replied, slurping up another spoonful. "So? You could still have answered. You're 13, not 3. Who did you think it was? Frankenstein's monster?" "Could have been," Aidan pretended to consider for a moment. then shook his head. Then we reckoned that was impossible. You being upstairs. Aidan grinned up at her, brown eyes glinting. Con spluttered, spraying milk and cornflakes all over the table. At 3 years younger, he was a miniature version of his brother. They looked just like each other, snorting with laughter, hair sticking straight up in identical copper-coloured convict cuts. "Where's Mum?" Finn asked again. "She's gone out for a walk. Did she take a sketch pad with her?" "How should we know?" Con dug into his cornflakes. "Oh, brilliant." Finn rolled her eyes to the ceiling. "She could be out all morning. What am I supposed to do about this bloke?" "What bloke?" "The one standing on the doorstep. He's come about work or something. Do either of you know anything about it?" Con shook his head. "There's a note on the fridge," Aidan supplied. "Auntie Carol must have left it." Auntie Carol was their mother's sister. They were here courtesy of her. It was her cottage. Finn went over and pulled the paper out from underneath the fridge magnet. "Expect a man about the work," she read. "Mr. Treherne." "Mr. Treherne," Finn snorted. "He doesn't exactly look like a mister to me. He doesn't look much older than you two and about as useful." Con laughed, showing a mouthful of cornflakes, and Aidan grinned. "I wouldn't go on if I were you," he said.
"Why not?"
Finn demanded. "He's not on the step anymore."
"Oh, hey!"
She whirled round to see Mike Treherne standing in the doorway.
"Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean..."
She left the sentence unfinished. She could feel herself going red. "Mr. Treherne's my uncle," the boy explained, his mouth twitching at her growing discomfort. "Sorry to disappoint you. Won't I do?"
"Yes, I'm sure,"
Finn's blush deepened.
"Perhaps one of you can go and look for Mum."
Her brothers nodded, but made no move to go.
"Right. Okay, then, I'll go and put some clothes on. Be back in a minute."
Finn walked down the hall to the sound of male laughter. It was probably just Con and Aidan, but she was sure she heard a deeper voice joining in. The blood thudded in her face as she mounted the stairs. She paused at the top and leant her cheek against the cool banister, trying to hear if they were talking about her, wondering why she felt so humiliated. She came downstairs, decently dressed in shirt and jeans, to find Mike Treherne quite at home. He was sitting at the kitchen table with a mug of coffee, talking about football.
"Down on holiday?" he asked when she came in.
"Sort of."
She flicked the kettle back on.
"We're here for the summer, looking after the place for my aunt. She owns it."
"I see."
He stretched his long legs out and leaned back from the table, looking round at them.
"Just you and your mum, is it?"
"Yes."
Finn spooned coffee into a mug.
"Dad coming down later?"
Nobody answered. The boys, fizzing and bubbling a moment before, fell silent. Even Con was subdued. Mike caught the look that passed between them. Their embarrassment spread to him.
"Oh, I'm sorry."
He looked up at Finn.
"Have I said the wrong thing?"
"Not really."
Finn poured boiling water onto the granules.
"He just doesn't live with us anymore, that's all."
"That's why we're here," Aidan muttered. "Charity cases. We can't afford a proper holiday."
Finn gave him a warning look, and the kitchen filled with awkward silence.
"My mother's not here at the moment."
Finn poured milk into her coffee.
"I really have no idea when she'll be back," she added, without looking at him.
"Oh, right."
Mike Treherne got to his feet. He was being dismissed. Tourists. They were all the same, especially English ones. Down here on holiday, thinking they owned the place. And they did, most of it, like the house he was standing in now.
"Thanks for the coffee. Tell your mother I called."
"Certainly,"
Finn replied, escorting him towards the door.
"We can expect your uncle when?"
"Whenever."
He stared back at her, his blue eyes as cold as hers. That was a put-down, and he didn't care for it.
"Someone'll be up this afternoon. I can see myself out."
Finn shrugged, "Whatever," and leaned on the unit, sipping her coffee.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.